17 years old and has a past medical history significant for autism and atrophy. And he presented with recent worsening of eczema in the setting of strep pharyngitis. So 5 days prior to admission, he woke up with a sore throat and fever. And by evening, his mother noted that he had a rash appearing like eczema from basically the area around his genitals all the way down to his feet. And at baseline, his eczema is generally only present in the crevices of his elbows and his knees.
So that was pretty good. I like that opening sentence. It was a good kind of brief synopsis of what you're about to tell us. And then so far, just following along chronologically. A couple of times you made eye contact with the mom and she was nodding affirmatively, which reassures us that the information you're getting is accurate. And that's awesome too.
So over days 3 and 4 prior to admission, the rash spread diffusely, covering about 70% of his body. And it was most apparent on his back, neck region and legs.
70% sounds very specific, but okay.
His mom was quite concerned about how quickly the rash was spreading, and also about how much of the skin was sliding off, really without even touching it. And the rash was also extremely itchy and bothersome. In some areas of the rash, most notably the posterior aspects of the legs, lower back, also had some areas of bleeding and also some light pus drainage. So his mother took him to the Franklin Square ED on Sunday, where the throat swab was done.
I guess it's unclear as to why he went to the Franklin Square Emergency Department, because you're telling us about a rash, but then he's going to the emergency department and then he gets diagnosed with pharyngitis, which is weird because I didn't really hear a lot about sore throat. I might have to go back and listen again.
They gave him the diagnosis of strep pharyngitis, and they prescribed the clindamycin on Sunday as well, and he was also advised to use Vaseline over the affected skin areas. Over the next couple days, the rash remained extremely itchy, continued to spread, and so he went to visit his primary doctor yesterday. And given that given the severity of the rash, poor oral intake of food, and also little urine output, she basically advised him to go to the ED. And the next thing they did was come here. A few notable things. He has had strep throat before, never has had this bad of an exacerbation. And he's also mother's unsure of whether he's taken clindamycin in the past. But there have been no new introductions of things like soap, detergents, or any new foods that he otherwise doesn't eat. So in the ED yesterday, he was afebrile with stable vitals. He did report his pain was an 8 out of 10, likely due to the itching. Derm was consulted, and yesterday in the ED, he was given a bolus of normal saline and was started on maintenance IV fluids. He was given ibuprofen, 600 mg for pain, and hydroxyzine for relief of itching. Labs were sent, so he got viral and bacterial cultures of some of the wounds. And his labs were notable for eosinophils, 24% of the white count of about 9. And his CRP was 5.9. CBC and CMP were otherwise remarkable. Past medical.
Just a little bit, I think yesterday with the other students, about how much detail to share, because you're still in the history of present illness and you're giving a lot of the laboratory data. And I think what we decided was we would just try to mention the one or two pertinent labs in the emergency department, but not necessarily have to list all of them, particularly if you're going to come back and list them again when we get to the lab section.
As I mentioned, atrophy and autism, no past surgical history. Menti's currently taking at home includes the albuterol 3 times a day, Claritin 10 mg, 10 milligrams orally, and a hydrocortisone cream that he generally gets over the counter. He has multiple allergies to seafood, eggs, dairy, grass, trees, and animals. From relevant family history, mother with eczema. There's others as well, but not relevant. Social history. Anthony's in the 10th grade and lives at home with his parents. Vitals on admission to the floor, his vitals were stable, and relevant physical exam findings. So when we saw him, he was lying down in no acute distress. His skin findings, so they're quite diffuse, hyperpigmented plaques. As I mentioned, lower back, flanks, abdomen, hands, knees. And there's also a lot of areas of erosion. Most significant areas of erosion and breakdown include the posterior thighs and lower back. But notably, there's no drainage, vesicles, villi, and there's no mucosal involvement anywhere. Just important to note that he was breathing comfortably and lungs were cleared auscultation bilaterally. No new labs were done on the floor other than what was taken in the ED.
So the physical exam, I think it was reasonable to kind of focus just upon the kind of the skin findings. And in this case, the relevant negative findings were related to respiratory, so demonstrating that you're thinking about kind of allergic processes. I liked that you commented specifically on the absence of mucosal membrane findings. That was important.
But notably, there's no drainage, vesicles, villi, and there's no mucosal involvement anywhere. Just important to note that he was breathing comfortably and lungs were cleared auscultation bilaterally. No new labs were done on the floor other than what was taken in the ED.
So I'm glad you didn't repeat the labs in the lab section. You included them in the HPI. I guess as long as they're showing up in one place or the other, I think it's fine the way you did it. I think the alternative would just be to kind of give a brief important lab in the ED and then maybe expand upon it here.
Diagnostic test, the only thing we did was the wound cultures. So interval history, since he was admitted overnight, I saw him this morning, it seemed like there's less itching. He mentioned he was in no pain, but the rash was largely unchanged. So the assessment plan to review, Anthony's a 17-year-old male with past medical history of apathy and autism. We presented with a worsening rash in the setting of strep pharyngitis and recent start of clindamycin treatment. So I think the most likely etiology for what's going on here is the exacerbation of eczema because of strep pharyngitis. And the physical exam findings he had, the redness, the itching, the plaques, and the elevated eosinophil count, which is just a white blood cell marker we look for, and the timeline are really all consistent with this diagnosis. Some other things that we were thinking about last night were dermatitis herpetiformis and erythema multiforme minor, and those also present similarly in terms of like the itching, kind of the same timeline, and you can get those with infections or drug reactions. But how the rash actually looks is actually a little bit different. So it's generally pink with red blotches and symmetric, so we don't think that's what's going on here. And some other like more severe drug reactions we just wanted to rule out are things like toxic epidermal necrolysis and Stevens-Johnson. We're pretty sure that's not what's going on here either. Those usually generally have mucosal involvement of like the mouth and things of that nature, and he doesn't really have any of that. Our plan for him while he's here is to treat the strep infection and to control the spread, pushing the rash, which we seem to be doing, and also to replete his fluids to seem dehydrated when he came in. So we consulted Derm, as you were yesterday, and they want to keep going with the 0.1% betamethasone ointment anywhere that's been affected. And they recommend we get the culture, which we did. Also continue with the Vaseline coverage.
That was good. I guess as I'm sitting here watching it, I'm wondering how much of what you're actually saying she's understanding. While we're comfortable with words like consult derm, I don't know if that's completely transparent to folks that means to consult a dermatologist who would come render an opinion. Some of the medications are kind of lengthy in their name. Some of the diagnoses that you're throwing at her are fairly complicated. So it just brings into question this issue of kind of family-centered rounds and whether the language we use in front of families might be somehow different than the words we might choose to kind of talk amongst our peers or amongst other medical providers. Otherwise, I thought the differential diagnosis was quite good. I have to say, after hearing the whole story, I was wondering if there was some element of superinfection, like it's eczema that's subsequently, turned into areas of cellulitis. And so maybe kind of an explanation as to why that wasn't considered. The other thing I'm thinking about is whether kind of the pathophysiology, like, so why did strep cause the eczema to flare up? So is this an issue related to kind of certain toxins that are related, released from staph or strep infections? So what's the underlying reason that you believe that the eczema was exacerbated by strep? And in fact, why didn't it get better when he was initially started on clindamycin? Otherwise, this was really fantastic, and I appreciate that you let us videotape this and make some comments.